Let us now solve a numerical example for maximum likelihood estimation. Let's say we have a sample of size 10. So here we have 10 observations. The sample size is 10. And these are my yi's, the observed random variable, right? These can be, for example, Sachin scores in 10 matches. Although the values are too low, they are unrealistic values. But let's say there are some observations. So if we take the total sum of this column, it would give us summation of all the yi's, right? And here, let us assume the functional form which is given by this expression. This we had actually seen earlier. This distribution is called the exponential distribution. Which is characterized by one single parameter, which is the theta. Now, please note here that you may not come across exactly the same form of exponential distribution in some textbooks. That could be because sometimes this theta is written as a reciprocal of theta, in which case it's just a different parameter that you're estimating. Do not worry about that. Here in this example, we are going to stick to this form of the exponential distribution. So, from this numerical example, what we are going to calculate is what is the MLE estimate, the point estimate of theta hat, what is the standard error of theta hat, and let's say we consider two significance levels. So at 90% confidence, what is the confidence interval of theta hat? And at 99% confidence, what is the confidence interval of theta hat? So these are the questions we will answer in this numerical example. Again, to summarize what we have from the maximum likelihood estimation method, we have an observed sample, which is of size n. We do know the probability distribution. So, observations are independent and identically distributed following the exponential distribution. The next step, what we know is, or what we can write from this, is the likelihood function, which is nothing but the joint probability of all the observations. Right? So, f of y1, y2, and so on, given a certain theta. And this we can write as in terms of the vector y, right? When we use the independent assumption and we use the log of the likelihood function, then we can write the log likelihood function, which is nothing but the sum of the individual logs. Okay. Then what we need to do is we need to optimize, which means we need to find out that value of theta which corresponds to the maximum value of the log likelihood function. So to get theta hat, we will differentiate the log likelihood function and equate it to zero. What else do we know? We know that the variance. So, theta hat, the point estimate, is not enough. We need to also report the standard error, which, and from that we can actually derive the confidence intervals. So, to get the standard error, we need the variance of this estimator. And this, we had seen that this is equal to negative of the second order derivative. The inverse of that evaluated at theta equal to theta hat. So remember, our distribution is given by theta times e to the power minus theta y. Now we need to differentiate the log likelihood function. So let's do that. summation of log and this we equate to 0. So when we actually carry out the differentiation, we know that the differentiation of the sum will be given by the sum of all the differentials. So del del theta of sum and let's differentiate this with respect to theta. So the first term would be log of theta, the second term would be theta times yi, right? And then we can remove this parenthesis because the differential of the sum is equal to the sum of the differentials. So when we are summing the differential of log of theta over n values, we get n by theta and we get summation of yi in the second term. This is equal to 0. So this means we get theta hat, the MLE estimate. So from this equation, we get an expression for theta, which is nothing but n by summation yi. So this gives an expression for the MLE estimator theta hat. And when we use the 10 values given in this sample, we sum all the yi's and n equal to 10. When we actually calculate, it turns out to be 0.162. So that's my estimator. And the variance of that would be obtained by the second order derivative. So minus del square L theta del theta square, the inverse of that. And this is evaluated at theta equal to theta hat. So when you actually calculate the second order derivative, plug in the value of theta hat. First we get it in terms of theta hat. So we get it as theta hat square divided by n. And then we can plug in the value of theta hat, which we have obtained as 0.162. So this comes out to be 0.0026. Right? So now we can now calculate the standard error of estimate, which would be nothing but the square root of 0.0026, something like 0.051. Right, so we have calculated theta hat, which comes out to be 0.162. We have calculated the standard error of theta hat, which comes out to be 0.051. And now we are going to use these to calculate the confidence intervals. Now remember, we have a generic expression for the confidence interval, which is nothing but the point estimate plus or minus critical value times standard error. And we are going to use the standard normal critical value, so z critical times the standard error of theta hat. So at 90% confidence, this means that 100 into 1 minus alpha is 0.9, so alpha is 0.1, and at 99% confidence implies alpha equal to 0.01. So we will be referring to the standard normal tables to find out what would be the z critical corresponding to alpha 0.1 and alpha 0.01. Okay, so we will now use the standard normal table for finding out the z critical values. Remember, z critical is nothing but the 1 minus alpha by 2th quantile of the standard normal distribution, which is given by z 1 minus alpha by 2. So at 90% confidence, we had alpha equal to 0.1 So we need to look at z 0.95, and at 99% confidence we have alpha equal to 0.01. So we need to look at z corresponding to 0.995. So the tables which are given in statistical textbooks, or you may also find them online, or they come for software packages such as MATLAB and R, they come already inbuilt. So we can write a single command to get the corresponding probabilities for a given quantile value, or if you give the probabilities, you can calculate the corresponding quantile value by one single line of command. Now here we are going to refer to a standard normal table which gives the probabilities. So the shaded area here represents area under a probability distribution, and that is the definition of the cumulative distribution function. So the shaded area would give the probability that any z is less than all the values that are mentioned here. So in this column we have the first digit after the decimal, and the second digit after the decimal is given in the rows. Sorry, in the columns, in the rows we have the first digit. So what would this mean is, let's take this example value 0.508. This would mean that the probability of any z being less than, so we have 0.0 first place of the decimal and then 0.02, so we use both of them up, so 0.02, that is 0.508. Let us take another example, maybe this one. So 0.9357, this would mean that the probability of any z being less than, we now have 1.5 in the first place after decimal and 0.02 is the second place after decimal. So probability of any z being less than 1.52 is equal to 0.9357. So you see here that the table is actually giving the probabilities and not the quantiles. Corresponding to each quantile, it is giving the probabilities. But we are interested in finding out quantiles corresponding to given probabilities. So now we have to look up where in this table do we see 0.95. So we see 0.95 somewhere here, right? So this we have to now take the reverse. So 0.95 corresponds to 1.6 first place of the decimal, and so it's actually somewhere between this 0.9495 and 0.9505, somewhere between these two that our z 0.95 lies. We can linearly interpolate between these two values. For all practical purposes, 0.9495 can be assumed to be equivalent to 0.95. So we take the 0.95 to be 1.64. So this is 1.64, right? Similarly, for alpha equal to 0.01, we need to find out where is 0.995. So let us look up where do we see 0.995. Here. Here the value is 0.9949. For all practical purposes, it is equal to 0.995, and that corresponds to 2.5 for the first place of the decimal and 0.07 for the second place of the decimal. So this is equal to 2.57. So we now have the two z critical values. Okay, so we now have all the information needed to solve this example. We already know the theta hat, we already know its standard error. We know the formula for the confidence interval. We have noted down the z critical values from the standard normal table. When we plug all of that in, we get the confidence intervals as 0.078, 0.246. And at 99% confidence, we have 0.03, 0.29, right? So these are our confidence intervals. Now, I had earlier asked you to think about two possible confidence intervals, one at 90%, the other at 99%, and which one do you think would be wider? Here we can see that the 99% confidence interval is wider, and that is intuitive because if you have assumed a wider range, you are more certain of the value lying within that range. If you have already narrowed it down, then there's a possibility that the estimate might lie outside of it, right? So that's all about how to find out the MLE estimator and its associated confidence interval for one single parameter, theta. In the next video, we will look at how we can use this to estimate multiple parameters at the same time.